computer. So today it's just me and Eric and you, Neil Steinberg. And I had a doctor's appointment the other day, and I took a copy of your book every day, of which I bought 10 or 12. And I carry it with me. And I knew at the doctor's appointment, I'll be sitting in the waiting room for a while. So I thought I'll just read this, leaf through it. So the doctor comes in. She goes, "You always have a book with you. What is it this time?" So I told her about the book. And she then looked it up on, I think, the Chicago Public Library app, and she didn't find it listed there. And she said, "Tell him to get it in the system." And then I told her about the book, and she goes, "Oh, that's so cool." And she says, "And I'm taking a flight soon." And so when our appointment was done, I said, "Listen, you can have this book." And she goes, "Oh, no, I can't take this." And I and then she looks at her assistant, the scribe that was with her, and she goes, "I don't think it's unethical for me to take a book, is it?" And maybe there's a cash threshold or something.
Bribing your doctor?
I know. And I thought, I don't think you are supposed to be accepting gifts from patients. That, I don't know. That to me is going in a funny direction. You shouldn't be doing that.
My test results aren't good. How about
exactly.
Now?
Exactly. So then she says, "Okay, I'm only going to take it if on your next appointment in 6 months, you call me before you come and I'll know to bring the book back. So I'm only going to borrow it." And I says, "No, I'm not going to do that. I want you to have this book. You'll enjoy it." And she blushed under her mask. She was so happy to receive it. So
I've corrupted you, John. I'm so sorry. I suborned some honest doctor.
I don't know that you did.
I have made it my practice not to borrow books.
Yeah.
Already, because if somebody says, I can loan you this book, I'll say, if it's really good, I'll buy it. And that's my threshold. And I'm glad to loan out my books, but if I'm going to loan them out, I'm going to give them away.
See, I don't loan them. I give them away.
It's like you just don't want that hanging over any relationship you have with an object. I mean, you can borrow a neighbor's lawnmower or something like that for half a book. I mean, it's always a thing between.
Really?
About a book. So I just say, if you want to give me the book, fine. I mean, I may give it back or I may not, but it's like, you're giving me the book. Or I'm going to go buy it. I don't mind buying a book if it's a good book. So,
well, I have a couple thousand books. And my friends, when we come over, we always talk about books. I was at a buddy's house a few years ago, and I was looking at his books. And I go, "Oh, I've got this one too. Oh, I've got this one too." So I pulled them off the shelves and I'm thumbing through them. And I go, "Wait, this is my handwriting in your book." And I realized he had like 10 or 15 books of mine, which over the months and years, I guess I had lent to him. I don't think he was stealing from me. But I confiscated them back. I took them away from him.
Some people are bad about giving them back. It's Friday. It's funny. My younger son's girlfriend is a doctoral student at the University of Chicago. And we were talking classical literature. And I asked her if she'd read Emily Wilson's translation of the Odyssey. And I said, "It's the first woman to translate it from the original Greek." And as I loaned her my copy, I almost circled back to my son and said, "Look, don't you break up with her without getting my book back." And then I thought, you know what, Dad, trust drop. You'll get it. Spend another $40, get another copy. And she read it and returned it. And I felt like saying, "She's
wow.
a keeper, man." Yeah, I'm going to tell the story at their wedding.
She's a keeper. Well, yeah. And did she comment in the margins? Did she put notes and underline things?
No, I don't believe in writing in books unless it's like a galley or something. I really. Which is odd because one of my favorite, let me show you something.
I write in all of my books. I underline things. I make notes on the back pages. It's more like a professional reference for me though. So then if I want to talk about it on the air, I just thumb through the pages and go, "Here's a passage I think is really good. And I've already read it and kind of highlighted it for broadcast." But
I just watch my reading on Kindle now.
This is my copy of the three volume Boswell Life of Johnson. You see all the post-it notes. But the thing is, it was annotated when the Life of Johnson came out in 1796 or whatever. Johnson's landlady, Hester Thrale Piozzi, marked up this copy where she's writing in the margins, like, "Oh no, it wasn't so. I thought him a rogue." And this version has those footnotes in it.
"I thought him a rogue."
It's like having a comment section or something, you know?
Yeah. It's so that's cool.
It's only this one particular, like 1961. I've never seen it before. or since, but it made it really fun. I mean, it's fun to read anyways, but it made it extra fun to read.
Wow.
Okay, you book nerds.
Sorry, we're making Eric uncomfortable. Let's talk about sports.
Let's talk about outrages in the news. What are we gonna get to today?
Well, we haven't done on this podcast yet, though it's almost a week old now, the story of Lori Lightfoot recruiting Chicago Public School students. We'll talk about that. We will talk about the similarities and differences, I think, between the classified documents stories, Trump and Biden. I want to talk a little bit about George Santos because it's just too much fun. And what else was there on our list, Eric? Let's see. Lightfoot, the Biden unforced error of that.
Well, I was gonna bring up this idea that the killer in the Walmart rampage in El Paso in 2019, he killed 23 people and they decided not to go for the federal death penalty on him. And, you know, I'm an opponent of the death penalty, but I think this ought to illustrate to anybody who is in favor of the death penalty how arbitrary and weird it's become, and how if somebody who murders 23 people in a hate crime doesn't get the, I mean, I'm unloading what I would say if we talk about it. If you don't give the death penalty to that, then you shouldn't give the death penalty to anyone.
Right. Well, and I do want to talk about the assault weapons ban, which is up against a legitimate challenge here. You know, Eric, you dismissed it, I think, rather handily in our last episode, but there's more and more evidence or argument anyway that it's not a slam dunk for this thing. If I had to bet, I'll ask you in the pod, which way do you think this is going to go? So we'll pick it up there, okay, guys?
Yeah, I like the assault weapons ban. I think there's a lot of meat on that.